Hey everybody, this is your brother, Narada, Michael Walden. Welcome to All In, my podcast where we break down music, life, and love, interviews, and conversations. Let's get into it. Kenny. I gotta sing for you, is that okay?
Please do.
Don't waste your time. My love is taken and easily found. There's none to spare. You'll find another somewhere. So don't waste your time. Don't waste your time.
My horns, I love it.
Sha-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Don't waste your time. Da-da-ba-ba-ba-ba. Don't waste your time. Da-ba-ba-ba-ba-ba. Sha-ba-wee-do-wee. Shoo-do-wee-oo. Gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter. Ooh, child, things are gonna get easier. Ooh, child, things will get brighter. Someday, yeah, we'll put it together and we'll get it undone. Someday when your head is much lighter. Kenny Burke, I love you. Someday, yeah, we'll walk in the rays of the beautiful sun. Someday when the world is much brighter. Yeah. Ooh, child, things are going to get easier. Ooh, child, things are getting brighter. Right now, yeah. Talk about right now. All over the world right now, Kenny. Feel it.
Oh,
right,
yes.
Now. Sing with me, Kenny Burke.
Yeah, yeah. Right now.
Yeah.
Yeah.
Right now. Yeah, yeah, yeah.
Right now. Oh, yeah.
And Kenny, the most sampled cat in history. There you are, and you know it. Yes, you are. You talking about?
Run into the top, give it all you got. We rise into the top, yeah. Give it all you got. We rise into the top, baby. We give it all you got. We rise into the top, yeah. We give it all you got.
Yeah, this is Kenny Burke right here.
Wake up your body, wake up your body, wake up your body and move it around.
Love you, Kenny. Oh, yeah, we do. Oh, yeah, we do.
Oh, no. My brother.
You got to know, I'm from Kalamazoo, Michigan. Way out in the sticks, and my dad's from Chicago, where you're from, and when we go to Chicago to visit his relatives and all that, the first thing that smacked me hard was your music, the Five Stairsteps. And I was just so taken that this family was so gifted, that all the harmonies were so pure, so rich, and so well put together, all of it. And then, of course, Curtis Mayfield to have his hand involved. And then we heard about your father being so deeply involved in music. We were just taken that these kids could be so young and have that kind of gift. So this is why I'm so honored to talk to you today, Kenny. Just from my childhood, as you know, we're so open when we're kids. We try to stay open. But you just smacked me. And I'm just here still smacked. So the floor is yours, Kenny Burke. Hit him, man. Hit him hard.
Okay, well, first of all, I got to just start out. I'm here with 3 5-time Grammy Award-winning producer of the year, Mr. Narada Michael Walden. We got to start there.
Oh, okay.
We got to start there.
Oh, okay. You're my teacher, Kenny. You're my teacher.
Oh, listen, I'm so humbled because, you know, I came from a truly blessed family.
Yes, Kenny.
Full of opportunities and just, I'll just say this, starting out, nothing was possible without my mom and dad.
Right.
that listened to us banging on pots and pans because we didn't have bongos. So that was our percussion, and hearing us doing all that. And I asked them, well, how did you tolerate that? Because I couldn't do it. I couldn't listen to it. They said, well, because it sounded like you were making music.
Oh,
it wasn't
right.
like you were just beating on pots and pans.
That's right.
And so we heard what you were doing. And my dad, of course, some may know, was a homicide detective in Chicago
right.
in the 50s and 60s. Okay. And my mother, back in those days, you know, our dad and mom, dad would work, mom could take care of the family. Yeah. So we were blessed to have a father who may have been something else because of his profession, but he was so gentle to us. He would come home after dealing with that kind of lifestyle, with actually shootouts and dealing with the hardness of life. And he'd come home, lay in the bed, and we all five of us would just jump on him, and he would play hand puppets with us, and just the most gentle, kindest man in the world. So I'm blessed. My family, we were blessed. We had great, great, great parenting and would love, but also, as you know, Narada, yes. back in our day,
yes,
we had the love, but we also knew our instructions.
Oh my God, yes, that's right.
And we were obedient,
yes,
and respectful. So starting off with my father, Clarence Burke Sr., and my mother, Miss Betty Burke, I lost my father a couple of years ago, but he's still with us with all he taught us. He passed away in 91, lived a great, great full life.
Yes.
And not COVID related, thank mm-hmm. God.
Okay.
And my mom is still here with us, and hopefully on Sunday we'll be celebrating her 93rd birthday.
Oh, wow. Fantastic.
So big props up to my mom and
yeah.
dad. And then I have to say, I got to talk about my oldest brother, Clarence, the captain,
yes, yes,
the captain,
yes,
the
yes,
captain.
Yes.
A lot of people don't know how humble my brother was, because he would always give away things he was doing to say someone else was doing it, because he didn't want all of the credit. But he was the one who did all of the choreography,
mm-hmm.
and he never danced a day in his life.
Okay.
But he taught us, he came up with these choreography ideas, and we took it and ran with it. And I can't leave out a gentleman by the name of Gregory Fowler.
Wow.
So when yes. we talk about Curtis Mayfield, and
yes.
we talk about my brother and my dad,
yes.
it was Gregory Fowler who wrote World of Fantasy,
okay,
who
okay.
wrote You Waited Too Long,
oh my
who
God.
Wrote Come Back.
Okay.
He was the one that got to shape.
Yes.
Greg Fowler.
Okay. Oh, beautiful. Is he still living? Is he still with us?
No, he passed away some years ago also.
Okay.
But my brother Clarence, my brother James, who was nothing shy of genius, mm-hmm. not only musically, mm-hmm. but he was a great artist. Mm-hmm. He had a scholarship to the Chicago Art Institute at 8 years old.
Okay, wow.
Where he won the Miss Gwendolyn Brooks Award in Chicago.
Right.
And my brother QB passed on, was a fantastic talent, could sing his butt off, and he was a ballet phenomenon.
Wow.
He danced for Arthur Mitchell with the Dance Theater of Harlem,
mm-hmm.
Alvin Ailey's crew, the Atlanta Ballet. I mean, he blossomed into his own self,
because
mm-hmm. you know, it was the Five Stairsteps in QB, and he outgrew all of us, and he was just this beautiful man. And just my brother Dennis, now we called him, you know, he was so beautiful, my brother Den. And the ladies loved him, you know.
Yes, yes.
And he was a hell of a dude on stage with that choreography. Now, that cat was smooth.
Mm-hmm. Okay.
He was smooth with it, you know. And then how did it all work, having four brothers mm-hmm. and one sister who's the oldest?
Right, okay.
Her name was Aloha then,
right.
but we call her Rami now. So my oldest sister up there on stage with us, Narada.
Yes.
We were so tight, still are, and we're so close. Everybody wants to think that there might have been something wrong why we stopped singing.
Mm-hmm.
that there had to be some tension or some friction, right, amongst us. No, none of that. We just got to a spiritual point in our life, okay, where we, and it was tough then, you know?
Yes.
You know, back in those days, the 60s,
yes.
the circuit was tough. It was, right. it was just a harder life.
Right.
And we started out so young, because I was 12, and then my oldest sister and brother, 5 years apart. So 12 up to 13, 14, 15, 16, 17, my sister. By the time we did this for 7 years.
Wow.
And when we hit that peak with Ooh Child.
Yes.
You know, when we got that kind of success.
Wow. Yes.
There's an old saying, you know this saying, you be careful what hit you catch. Remember? Because you have to follow it up.
Oh, yes, of course.
And it has to be true to who you are.
Yes.
So we called a pop hit. It was a pop record. R&B wasn't even playing it. The VON didn't go on it.
Oh, I see.
WLS played it.
Right.
WLS and C something. Anyway, it went pop. Jimmy Bishop and Butterball out in Philly, WDAS, flipped it because it was a Dear Prudence A-side Beatles song.
I know it.
And we had Stan Vincent, who was this young, cool, white brother who was producing us. So we went with that. But catching that pop success for our R&B bass, that was a little delicate. How to balance that.
Yes.
So we just got to a point where we just said, you know, we want to just experience life.
Right.
And go and just, you know, we were okay with it. We were okay. So we parted on our own terms. Okay. We weren't handed our hat. We decided ourselves to say, thank you. But we want to leave the party for now. And then we came back.
Yes. Yes.
Then we came back. You know.
Well, before you come, let's pause on that part because I want to go back just a minute because I'm such a fan of the sound of what you did in that early period as well. I'd like to just ask a few questions. For example, sure. I love the vibes, the bass, drums, the feel of those early records. How did that happen? Can you just speak about how you just did that so early in your life? Can you speak about that?
Sure. Well, I'll tell you this. Our first session when Curtis brought us to, I think it was Universal Studios in Chicago.
Okay.
When we walked in the door, it was Studio A.
Right.
Guess who was in Studio B?
Don't know.
Janis Joplin.
Oh, I see.
Okay. Hmm. All right, Janis Joplin in Studio B. We walk into Studio A, the main room, with all these strings and horn and this orchestra. And we ask Curtis, so, wow. So whose session is this? And in his voice, he said, it's for you, babies.
That's right. That's right.
For you, babies.
That's
and
right.
We walked in and we saw all of that, Narada.
Mm-hmm.
And, you know, there was a guy named L. Duncan back then who was one of the session drummers. He did all the Regal Theater Orchestra stuff with Red Sanders.
Yes. Okay.
So L. Duncan is playing drums on that Don't Waste Your Time.
Wow.
All that shuffling stuff.
Go, 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 go. All that stuff. Great.
Yeah, all that stuff.
Lenny
Brown, who was Curtis's bass player in the band. And those guys were the rhythm section.
Okay.
And Johnny Pate, the great Johnny Pate, arranger.
Okay.
So Johnny Pate, that sound, that impression sound with Curtis.
Yeah.
A lot of that was Johnny Pate.
Okay.
Yeah. I mean, those arrangements and that sound, that was him. That was him doing that.
Mm-hmm.
So we walked in and saw all of that. And then we was, you know, shown to the vocal booth.
Mm-hmm.
And everything is done back in those days in one take.
Oh,
you get
God.
A second shot.
Oh.
But there aren't no threes and fours. You get a sound check, and are you ready?
Yeah.
And let's go. You get one look at it to say, okay, do this a little different. Watch your enunciation, because, you know, we were big on enunciation back in there, you know.
Right.
And though after those things, second take, that's it.
Okay, Clarence, he is like a young Curtis. So professional. So even the nuances are just so sophisticated. speak about him. He's like a out of this world.
16 years old.
Yeah, he's out of this world.
Second album. No, it's like people don't know how talented and gifted he was at that age.
Yeah,
16, right. 16, writing, playing, singing, choreography. And my dad talked Neil Bogart at that time, Neil Bogart and Cecil Holmes, mm-hmm. who were our label executives, into letting Clarence do our second album because Curtis was busy at the time. Mm-hmm. It was time for us to do our second album. And then my dad got Clarence the shot. To do our second album, the whole album.
Wow.
At 16, he is one of the true greats. I mean, mm-hmm. you know, when it's talked about something unsung or untold, mm-hmm. my brother, and so humble. Yeah. And so humble. Mm-hmm. And he wanted everybody to participate, even when you shouldn't have.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Okay.
You know, I mean, vocally, he was the guy. Mm-hmm. I got his, I got the songs that were out of his key. Like if Curtis wrote a song and he didn't really feel it was him, that's how I got leads with Ooh Baby Make Me Feel So Good.
Yeah. Okay.
That's how I got it. Yeah. And okay. he would say, no, let Kenny do it.
Okay.
Yeah.
Did Curtis spend a lot of time with you? Did he was yes. he like a part of your family or?
Oh, absolutely. You know, visitation to the house. You know, and he was, you know, Curtis was it in Chicago. He was what Barry and Smokey was to yes. you in Michigan, right?
In Detroit, yeah.
That's right. So Curtis is the guy. So can you imagine 12 year old teenagers up to 17 having the man who is the greatest talent in Chicago?
Right.
For your first opportunity.
Right.
Yeah. I could go on and on, so just ask away.
Mm-hmm. Were you playing the bass at that time? Was he like, did you play bass and he played guitar? Would you have a chance to interact in that regard?
Great. Let me tell you. My mom and dad got Clarence a silver tone guitar.
Right.
Okay, you remember Silvertone?
Silvertone, yes.
What it was the guitar and the case and the amplifier is already in the case. It's all right. Just all in one, right? Mm-hmm. So Clarence already was starting to write and show promise as a writer because we had Gregory Fowler, who was like a big brother to all of us, that was already writing these songs. And then Clarence took and started learning up under Gregory Fowler.
Wow.
To put it in its proper,
I love it.
You know, perspective. Mm-hmm. This is before Curtis. So my brother Clarence was already getting into his writing and learning his craft. And he was also a big Smokey Robinson fan.
Right. I hear that too.
So Smokey, you know, lyricists, come on. Poet, just words, you know, I would build you a castle with a tower so high it reaches the moon. You know, I'll make the melodies for birdies that fly and compose you a tune.
Yes.
I mean, so he was looking at the right kinds of people to follow. And then he became really great at what he was doing himself. So when it came to time for my bass playing, mm-hmm. it was Lenny Brown, the bass player for Curtis, that I would just watch him play that bass. Wow. And I was like, oh, man. This is it. The bass is it, you know? Mm-hmm. And I learned how to play bass on my brother's Silvertone guitar.
Oh, I love it.
I was playing the four mm-hmm. strings mm-hmm. and playing the parts mm-hmm. from our first album. Yes. And then I would tell my dad, I said, look, I know the licks, but I need a bass.
Right.
So Curtis, Dad, I got a Hagstrom bass. They got me a Hagstrom. Mm-hmm. And I just took from what I already had learned on the six-string guitar and transposed it to the bass. And once I got a feel for the difference of the strings and the weight, by our second album, I was doing sessions.
Right. Now, I got to pause 13. You again. I got to pause you because, see, playing bass in that style is such a great art form that changed music and changed the world. We know it from the Detroit side of James Jameson, how even the Beatles were like, in awe of his playing. In Chicago, right. It's the same thing. The bass work is phenomenal. And what you put down is phenomenal. and we adore it. It's like a lost art now, because now everything's just like one pad. But back then, you had to skip and move, and it was delicious. It was luscious. It was yummy.
Yeah. Yep.
And that's you.
Yep. Wow.
Talk about it, because we don't want to lose that.
Well, you said it right. James Jamerson.
Okay.
Let's just go right there.
Okay.
Go right there. And I listen to every Motown record. I never have heard him miss a note.
Yeah, that's what I'm saying.
He never missed a note. never a bad note. Never a bad note.
No.
So, but the thing with Jamerson was, you could play the licks, but the tone.
Right. Okay.
The tone. Mm-hmm. So even as a young guy, 13, I was aware of the tonality. I was like, oh, wait a minute. I know the notes, but man, to get those double stops and get that muted feel and be able to really, you know, you can't just play that if you're not going to get it articulated right. So much is going into the thought and so much is going into the feeling. And we didn't have five strings then.
Right.
Four. So you had to hold out when you could get the lowest note, the lowest octave. You would wait for it. You might not drop that low note on them until maybe one or two bars in the verse. But then when you would get to the bridge and then when you hit that vamp, then that's when you let them have it. You give it to them.
That's
what Jamerson was masterfully able to choose. How, you know, then drop it down on you?
Yes.
Oh, man.
Yes.
So I'm still trying to get that.
Kenny, do you remember, do you know this? On the session where you played bass on My Awakening at the Stevie Wonder Studio in Los Angeles, do you know, walking down that hallway to the studio room, I saw this gentleman. And he stopped, and I shook his hand, and he said, I'm James Jamerson. Do you know he was there at that session?
I don't know if it was the session we did, but I met him. Maybe it was us.
That was it.
Yeah,
I'm telling you, there he was. Yeah,
there
I was
we,
so.
Oh, man.
Yeah.
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 God bless us, man. God bless us.
Yeah, we were at the right place at the right time, weren't we?
Yeah, that's right. Absolutely true. And here's one more story, just because I want you to know this.
Please.
The first album I ever made was done in London with the Philharmonic, with the Mavishnu Orchestra, and George Martin produced it. And George Martin told us, because I said, I'm from Michigan, you know, Detroit, or Kalamazoo. He said, you don't understand. We did everything in our power to make the bass sound like the James Jamerson Motown records, and we couldn't get it. It was so, it frustrated the engineer, Jeff Emmerich, so much that they finally decided that, well, it must be because of the AC. The voltage is different in Michigan and America than the European. That must be part of it. And I had to tell George, no, you don't understand. It's this man's hands, this man's heart, this the way he played. So he understood. But Paul McCartney, all those guys, they were trying to get that.
Great story, along with the rest of the world.
Along the rest of the world.
Trying to get it.
Yeah,
all the bass players trying to get the tone. And we still don't have it. We still ain't got it.
Okay, here's another question. How did you feel when you were so seemingly overnight, and I know it wasn't overnight, but seemingly to be so young, then to be so huge, so famous, where we had to see you. You're playing the Regal Theater, you're doing the things that are like out of this world. How did that affect you? How did that feel to you?
Fun. A lot of fun.
Yeah, man.
And we didn't take it serious. I mean, now don't get me wrong.
Yeah.
We suited and booted when it was time to show up. We took our craft very, very serious.
Right.
And you know, I mean, when you got your father, you know, they're, you know, behind you. And, you know, we took our craft serious, but it was fun, man. Going on that stage and hearing those fans scream and really, really, they're really loving it. This isn't like fake stuff. They're really feeling you. So, it was incredible. Incredible.
I've been in that room and I heard those screams and it's like Beatles. It's like way over the top. I don't know why the room is just so alive that when they scream in there, it's just like curdling.
Yes.
So I know you've, that's what I'm talking about. You experienced that. I was like, to me, it just changed me to hear that sound.
Oh, man, listen, when you felt that energy,
yeah,
and then it would just charge you to come right back harder, and then from that moment on, you're just on another level. Because we're feeding off of the crowd, aren't we?
Yes, brother. Yes,
we are. We feed off the crowd. Yes. We need that energy, and that transposes into us. So, no, we had so much fun. So much fun.
Was your father also a bass player or something? Was he also a bass player?
Let me tell you, my dad, we laughed about this down the road.
Okay.
My dad was never a musician.
Okay.
It was because times were so lean. You know, you didn't really have money back then. You know, you're doing good just to get your uniforms, your outfits, and travel and get where you got to go.
That's right.
And hotels, you know, and feet. You know, mom had a hot plate. You know, it's five children. You know,
yes.
These aren't grown men. These are children, you know, and we're all packed in my dad had a red station wagon, a Chevy station wagon. So we're all packed 12, you know, 11 deep in this thing. Mm-hmm. And all of the equipment is packed on top of the station wagon where it's almost caving in. You can start to see it starting to give a little bit. And we had a Utah station wagon behind us. So we're all packed in like this. And my dad, the question you asked, never played bass until we couldn't afford a bass player.
Okay. And
he learned how to play the bass.
See. Okay.
He learned how to play the bass. Right. This guy is so, my dad, incredibly, I mean, can you imagine the heart you got to have to know I'm not really a bassist and you're out there on the road with guys who play. And he had a Gibson ES something, because it was the hollow body, the violin big bass, right? And he played with his thumb, Narda. He played with his thumb.
Wow, okay.
So, but he did the gig.
Uh-huh.
He did the gig.
Yeah.
And we would sit back. Now, this is just, you know, all in fun and love. You waited too long, had a bass line that started in D. And then Lenny did a slide, a glissando, boom, boom, boom. You remember that? Boom,
yes, I do.
Boom, boom,
yes.
Boom, right? So my dad, with the thumb playing, and never knew scales and never had that kind of proficiency, when we're on stage, we would all look at each other because we knew it was going to happen. We just didn't know when it would happen, uh-huh. That he would miss the gliss and go from the D up to the F. Instead, he would go ball, boo, 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 boo. So we would all be on stage. We didn't know when it was going to happen, but we knew he's going to miss it one or two times. So we would just laugh at all of these things. And my dad, he'd get calls from guys, "You don't know, Mr. Burke, how much you inspired me to become a bass player." And my dad would look at me and I'd look at him and he would be like, "Son, what was I doing?"
Right. Yeah, because the word got out that your dad played bass.
Like, yeah, oh, but he didn't.
Oh, okay, but he didn't.
He didn't really play bass.
Okay.
You know, okay. But he did the gig.
Yeah.
And he learned it in like a couple months. Mm-hmm. Who can do that? Mm-hmm. So hats mm-hmm. off to him mm-hmm. to have learned it in a few months and then actually go out on stage mm-hmm. and perform. What, I mean, come on.
Yeah,
who can
sure.
do that?
Yeah.
Who can? So that's a lot where we got it from. Mm-hmm. You know, he had, oh, and my dad could sing.
Okay, both.
Oh,
okay.
He could sing. Arthur Prysock offered him a gig.
Oh.
Back when he was young, he told us. Okay. So no, he had talent. I could tell you so many stories, but you know.
You know, I got to say one more thing, because I'm still in my youth now. In Chicago, it was quite rough. I'll go visit my cousins and all that. And they would show me, "Oh, you know, I got stabbed today." I said, "You got stabbed today? I'm from Plainville, Michigan. You got stabbed? Oh, yeah. Let me show you my wounds." They were to pull up the pant. I got stabbed there. I got stabbed there. I got stabbed there. And there's the gang around the corner, the Blackstone Rangers, whatever. They stabbed me, whatever. And it was like everyday occurrence. Was that your reality of being in the violence of Chicago, or not necessarily?
No.
Good. Okay.
We were never exposed to it.
Good. Okay.
However, You know, my dad kept us moving into nice neighborhoods.
Okay.
To where we finally moved into a home, 99th and King Drive. When you got up that high in the 90s and going into the hundreds, then you were in the suburbs. You know,
it was still,
you know, more white families living there. So we had a very good neighborhood we lived in. However, what you said is poignant, because that was one of my dad's motivations for giving us a shot in music business.
Okay.
Because he knew the downsides of the music business. Right. He was concerned about the lifestyle in the music business for us being so young, being exposed to an adult life. But at the same time, that was his main concern. The Blackstone Rangers, the disciples, they were coming up, and Clarence was the older child. So he was the one that would have been exposed to it. And my dad saw that. And he said, okay, I'm going to go on and let you guys go on and do this, because he was very concerned about that. Exactly what you said. So it's amazing that you brought that up, because that was the catalyst that gave us the opportunity, because our father saw that growing in Chicago.
Wow, man. Wow. And one more thing is, I know it's a God gift, the passion for the music. I know it's a God gift, that desire to want to make this great music, write these beautiful songs, sing it, play it, all that. Is it something in that era that just made us love the music so intently? Like everything that came out had this beautiful thing. Even Monkey Time by Major Lance was gorgeous. Even easier said than done. Even pop, anything had just beauty about it that we're like, we're just taken. Stevie Wonder out of fingertips in the Regal Theater. Just all that sound. Then you guys come out. All, whatever it is, it's like, it all is just so romantic and gorgeous and passionate. Was that just our fabric? Is that who we are?
I think so.
Whatever that says to you.
Well, for me, what you just said was, it was just so much written. The music was just rich.
Yes.
You know, what's your name? Isn't Mary or Sue? I mean, just the tone. It's so hard to find a personality with terms like yours for me. Ooh-wee, ooh-wee, ooh-wee. Everybody had their own style. You knew the difference between the Temptations and the Miracles.
Right.
You knew the difference between the Impressions and I mean, Gene Chandler.
Oh, yeah. Yeah, that's right. Duke of Earl and all his stuff. He was great.
I mean, everybody and the orchestration.
Yes.
The orchestration.
Yes.
And the lyrics.
Yes.
You know, talking about love, you know, kindness, you know.
Yes.
And people strived back then to want to be their best.
Yes.
To be the best.
Yes, brother.
Right?
Yes, brother.
You want it to be, you wanted to refine yourself.
Yes.
Where you would walk and talk differently. So nowadays, it's like, if you come from the hood, well, let's stay right where we are. The hood is what is going to give us strength, is going to give us credit, make us credible. We don't want to, you know, if we say, hi, good morning, how are you? Oh, it's a pleasure to meet you. That's soft. Yo, what's happening, my dog? I mean, I get it, but you cannot deny that we had the real richness.
Yes.
We were wealthy. We came up at a time where it was abundantly wealthy. It was just our parenting, the neighborhood. I mean, wherever we were, even if it was good or bad, you still could find your way to do something if you wanted to choose that. So no, the music, and then you had the East Coast, had its own vibe.
Mm-hmm.
West, you know, we had our vibe in the Midwest, and then the South, you know, Otis Redding, Jackie Wilson. I remember saw Jackie Wilson the first time on American Bandstand, and when that dude Narada came out doing those moves, come on now, undeniable. You could not deny anyone back in those days their talent on point. style, finesse. Finesse.
Yes.
That's a word that we don't hear about so much anymore.
I want to tell you this. I got to tell you this. Toys. I got to tell you one thing. At the Regal Theater, I saw Stevie Wonder. I had to go see him. But before he came out, there were two things. One was a guy I'd never heard of named Daryl Fletcher. And he danced across the stage. He was from Chicago. He was a young cat. And he just wore it out as well. So I was very impressed by him. But then out came this guy that later in my life inspired me to write for Mariah Carey, I Don't Want to Cry. And why? When he came out in the wheelchair, his name is Walter Jackson. He sang a song called
Walter Jackson.
It's Uphill Climb to the Bottom. And when he got to the modulation part of the song, he fell on the floor out of the wheelchair singing It's Uphill Climb to the Bottom. And the girls just screamed at him falling on the floor. And I'll never forget it. So I told Mariah when I met her, I said, you have to have a song that's got the drama of this man falling out of the wheelchair on the floor with like Walter Jackson at the Regal Theater. I'll never forget it. Do you know what I'm talking about for this guy?
Walter Jackson? Do you know what I'm talking about? Are you kidding?
I have to tell you, man.
Walter Jackson. And then he eventually would sing with his crutches.
Oh, yeah. Okay.
And stand up and sing with crutches. Walter Jackson. Oh, the great Walter Jackson.
Yeah.
Oh, man. Yeah. So. And Daryl Fletcher. I remember Daryl Fletcher.
Okay.
Now, when we're talking about the Regal, let me tell you something. Yes. Our first show at the Regal was with Smokey and Miracles.
Oh, okay.
And I remember when they introduced us, because we were the opening act. We were all going on stage at the same time, and Smokey was in the wings watching us, and he held Clarence back and didn't let him go out. He said, no, you wait. He said, now go.
Okay.
When it's time to sing.
Right, okay.
So he held him. Because we were trained, we all go out and hit it. He said, no, you wait. We're already out there. Finger popping, you know. And then he said, okay, now you go.
Beautiful.
All those little jewels, man.
Yeah.
So Narda.
Yeah.
All this that we're talking about.
Yes, man.
Can you imagine what that means when you're a teenager, when you're still children?
Yes, I do.
Can you expose to all of this as children?
Yes. But that's why, Kenny, you went on to play on the greatest records of all time. When you went to Los Angeles, the wealth you brought from Chicago in your life, you're on playing with everybody. And when I met you out there in LA, you were the hottest cat in the world. You are the hottest cat in the world. So, you know, it's because you brought that wisdom with you. You brought James Jamison. You brought the Curtis Mayfield.
Wow.
You brought that education to the West Coast. You brought that to the West Coast. You did.
Yes.
Before Prince, before any of that stuff was you. Let's just be straight about it.
Well, you know, I would be the oldest.
Yes. Okay.
You know, I would be their senior. Yeah. You know, Michael, Prince. Yep. Yeah. These are all.
But you brought that pop and you brought that thing, man. You brought it. You did. I saw you do it.
May I say this?
Yes.
Because this is a time for giving props, for praising those whose shoulders we stood upon.
Yes, that's right.
Right? You do it all the time throughout your career. You've always prayed Mahavishnu. I've always heard you start there and give it there.
Yes.
You know, the graciousness and the humility. So in my case, what made me so popular, I already had the fingering style, but when I met Larry with Sly and the Family Stone,
yes, brother, yes,
it was another transformation, because what he was doing on that bass was equivalent to what Jamerson was doing, okay, in the way of inspiration and sound and tonality and something that you never heard before and you never quite got it. Right. What is this dude doing? And I was blessed for him to take me as a younger brother. He never taught me. Okay. He would never show you.
Okay.
But he let me be in his circle, immediate circle enough to where I could watch and learn.
Yes.
And when he was playing with the thumb, what was the real secret wasn't the thumb and the pop. It wasn't the thumping and the popping. It was the left hand, what he was doing on the fretboard. because he's playing, he's muting and getting that percussive thing. And when I discovered it and I saw it, I said, oh, and then I would go off to myself and practice. And I say, Larry, I think I figured it out. He said, okay. And then I showed it to him and he would just,
okay.
That's how we interact. Listen, I'm 17 years old staying at his house.
Oh, I didn't know.
In Oakland.
This. Did not know this, man.
Oh, no. We're big brother, little brother. Oh, no. This wasn't just a passing moment. No. No, we were family, big brother, little brother, you know? And when he did the Grand Central Station thing, he wanted me to be in the band and also play in case he had to go out and still do something else. Okay? So at the end of the day, Larry Graham, when we say James Jamerson, I think.
Yes.
There's a lot of great bass players.
Yes.
Chuck Rainey. I mean, there's a lot of great guys.
Yes.
You know?
Yes.
And one of my favorites, the young lady who played all those pop records.
Carol Kay.
Carol Kay.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah. People don't know how badass she was. Mm-hmm. You know, come on. Mm-hmm. This lady had a thing. Mm-hmm. But Larry Graham changed the bass forever.
Okay. I got two quick Larry Graham stories. I got to just share.
Yes.
You're bringing it to my...
Yes, yes.
When I first saw Larry Graham was in Chicago again, there was a theater where the seats would go up. The stage would be down. Sly and the Family Stone would be down that stage. All the chairs and seats would go up. But during one of the part of the show, when he's just going crazy, Mr. Larry Graham,
yep,
he hit a pedal, and the whole sound of the auditorium went, but up under the earth, it was just the biggest, deepest sound. Like now we're used to kind of hearing that with subwoofers, but that was back before they had subwoofers. That was back in the 60s.
Right, right.
It was,
yeah.
It was just awesome. So that's my number one story. Then I have to also say, graciously, he played on a record we just did for the Temptations called When We Were Kings. It's the King, we're talking about Temptations back in the day, the glory of the 60s. But Larry is playing bass. Oh, my God. So, and then let's say third.
Yeah.
How he changed Prince's life.
Yeah.
See, Prince is genius. Larry, come live with me.
Yeah.
No, come live with me, right? Teach me. And then there you go. So all these things, man. God bless, man.
Yes.
Okay. That's all I'm saying.
Yeah. So back to my session.
Yes,
my session days.
Yeah.
It wasn't something I saw. I didn't go out to LA to be a session guy. Oh, I want to go out and break into the sessions.
Right.
No. People heard that, what I learned and picked up from Larry, and they were like, oh my God, we've never heard this ever before to be able to be on record, because Larry was so close to the vest with it, you weren't gonna find out what he was doing. I guarantee you that.
Mm-hmm.
He didn't let you get close to him
when
he was playing that. So he gave me the gift, and then I ran with it to LA, and that's when we met, and that's when I became the hot bass player I was. Yes. I got to give props where they're due.
Okay, for those who don't know, on my third album called The Awakening, is Keni Burke on bass. It's called The Awakening Suite Part 1, The Awakening of the opening of the heart, the childhood. And then it goes into Part 2, the Awakening Suite, which features then Carlos Santana. Part 1 features Ray Gomez on guitar and you on the bass. And we had great musicians of Greg Fillinganes and Jay Gray and all those great, Pat Thrall and Jimmy Schiffler doing the engineering and all that. But Part 2 is when Carlos Santana stepped in and just wore it out with Ayerto on percussion and all that. And you're just phenomenal on the bass. So I just want to just let everyone know that, you know.
Do you know how I felt? Thank you. Do you know how I felt when Santana came in, Carlos came in and sat in the chair? And I'm like, what the heck is going on? That, your session, for me as a young Keni Burke, you exposed me to the greatest musicians at that moment, where I'll be honest with you, I can tell you now.
Okay.
I was just trying to keep up, man, because it was like I was overwhelmed with, oh, I'm here, you know, with these great guys. So, and you on, with them double bass drums.
Yeah.
I mean, you was double bass drumming it, man, before that was even done. Mm-hmm. I was like, what? Here's why sometimes I wasn't able to absolutely do my thing because I'm watching it all. I was like watching. I'm like, wait, this guy's doing. Yeah. So no, man. Wow. And I end up playing on almost 3,000 records.
I know. Your discography, you sent me, I mean, I knew a lot of it, but a lot I don't even know because it's so much. Yeah. You play with everybody.
Yeah. Yeah.
Speak on anything you want
to
say.
And never was trying to.
Okay. It just happened. It just happened.
And I was never trying to be that guy.
Mm-hmm.
I didn't set out to be that guy. It just bought me in, you know, it just, the door opened and I just walked in.
Your connection with
Bill Withers.
Yes. Go. Talk.
Bill Withers.
Yeah.
I met Bill in a session. He you know, invited me to play on an album that was the Menagerie album that would have A Lovely Day on it.
Yes.
Which was already recorded. And I stayed and I said, okay, Bill, after the session, is there anything else that you need? Is everything good? You're loving everything. Because I heard a few things I'd like to touch up if you don't mind.
Oh, okay.
And he said, oh, come on. Yeah. Oh,
okay. Mm-hmm.
So I went into the control room. And I said, yeah, that part right there. Let me go on and punch in on that.
Mm.
And then fixed it. He said, oh, it was just a few spots. I said, okay, great. And then he said, Keni, I'm getting ready to do this soundtrack for Woody Allen and Diana Keaton, a movie called Looking for Mr. Goodbar. He said, would you like to come in and co-produce it with me?
Wow.
Right then on the spot.
Wow, I love it.
Right at that moment. So back again, you know, we've done a lot, Narda. Yes. We've been blessed, right?
Yes.
And
yes.
And let's keep it real. We had to put the work in.
Mm-hmm.
You know, we put the work in to become at a level where we could do it.
Yes.
But I got to be honest and say, most of the best things that ever happened to me in my life were gifts.
Right. Beautiful.
Were gifts. Mm-hmm. Were gifts. Where somebody saw me and saw something else in me, not just the playing. Because there's a lot of badasses out there that can play.
Yeah,
but the people who bless me with love, like yourself, I think saw that, oh, this guy is cool.
Yeah.
You know, like minds. One, and he brought me right in as a co-producer.
Mm-hmm.
That was a gift.
Yes. Okay.
It was a gift. And we became lifelong friends until he passed away. 2 years ago, lifelong friends. Mm-hmm. We were FaceTiming the week before he passed.
I see.
So now let's talk about the other Billy.
Okay. Well, before you move on, I want you to know one thing. Sting, who's my dear bro, I'm actually wearing a shirt that we both share. This shirt I'm wearing in honor of you.
Yeah.
Sting is turned out by Bill Withers. He adores Bill Withers. More than anybody is Sting. Just want you to know that.
Wow.
Yeah, I just want you to know that.
Wow. Yeah. Wow. Well, see? Wow. Well, that's right.
Yeah,
that would be
exactly.
Right. I mean,
exactly.
The man was a genius lyricist.
That's right.
There his style, how he, the way he could speak about a song and this wittiness he had.
Right.
Wit. Mm-hmm. You know, he would tell me this story, and I tell it to all young people today. He said, Keni, you always had these anecdotes. And he would say, see, the thing about friends and family is, it's not that I'm not strong enough to pull them up, but it's that they're heavy enough to pull me down.
Oh, yeah. Got it.
And I would be like, check, and double check.
Mm-hmm. Mm-hmm.
I mean, just giving you those jewels of wisdom that if you understood what he meant can carry you through your life and you'll know how to navigate, right?
Yes, yes.
And just brilliant, just a brilliant man.
Mm-hmm.
And a good man to his family and his wife, just a good man. So the great Bill Withers. Wow.
Yeah. Okay.
You know?
Okay, now you mentioned, you said Billy Preston you wanted to speak about.
Billy Preston.
Yes.
Billy, man. So he was a fan of the family also.
Right.
We met Billy at the Apollo. He came to see us when he would be in town. He'd come to the Apollo, and he was always so, oh, wow, just big smiles and energy and love and how much he just was, oh, man, into what we were doing. And then he invited us because Clarence and I were more of the musicians in the family at that time. Even though Dennis and James played guitars, but Clarence and I, for some reason, the younger and the oldest brother, we had such a thing together, Clarence and I, that we kind of would go out on our own and experiment. So Billy invited us to come to LA, you know, my brothers went out and hung out, but then I was off into my spiritual phase of life where I totally went and studied Islam and got away from the whole lifestyle and purified my soul, got out of all of the, you know, the showbiz stuff and cleaned my life up. And then I went back into the business.
Okay.
And then Billy and I hooked up here in Atlanta, where I am now.
Okay.
Back in 74. Okay. And we hooked up. He was here. And then he said, Kenny, you need to come back and play, man.
Right.
You can't, you know, come on, man. You come back. So I said, okay. Flew out to Panga Canyon, California. Rest was history. Don Kirshner's Rock Concert, Midnight Special.
Yeah, yeah.
And he was such, people don't know, they know Billy was a genius on those keys, but he was also so inspirational. He was always the baddest cat wherever he was. No one was more talented than Billy Preston, for sure, yes, right?
Right.
But he also would know how to sit back. He didn't always have to shine. He didn't always have to, his ego wasn't always in the forefront. He could be in the background and let you be the star and encourage you and say, come on, come on, come on, you can do it. And so I have had so many big brothers, man, in my life that have pushed me along this road. And we just did Billy's interview for his documentary. Let me put that out there.
Okay.
White Horse Pictures with the great director Paris Barkley are doing with Olivia Harrison, Billy's, not Billy, George's wife.
That's right.
And son, Donnie Harrison, are the executive producers. So we're going to have a Billy Preston documentary coming out next year.
Oh.
And this company has only done the likes of the Beatles, the Bee Gees, and Pavarotti. So this is going to be top notch. It's going to be great. And Billy's going to get his due and be, you know, properly represented by people who loved him and knew him.
Joyce Moore, Sam Moore's wife, is going to be ecstatic.
She is
the biggest fan of Billy Preston. Whenever I talk about Billy Preston, I hear her face comes right in front of my eyes.
She loves him. We're dear friends. Joyce is the one that recommended me for the interview. No, Joyce and I, dear friends.
Okay. And Sam Moore, incredible as well. Yeah.
Oh, man, look, going back into Philadelphia, when Sam, I actually know and saw Sam and Dave when it was happening. When it was on. Hold on, I'm coming. Yeah, yeah, yeah. Those two dudes came out there.
Yeah.
Forget about it. So beautiful. Yeah.
Wow. I gotta say, when I met Billy Preston for the first time, was on an Al Green tribute called Room 101 that Don, the bass player Don, put together. I forget his last name. Yeah. And I played the drums, and it was like and one day we'd meet all these different people, but Billy Preston playing the organ and meeting him and touching his hand, being so soft. The smell of his breath was like cotton candy. He was just so sweet. I just couldn't believe how sweet he was, because I didn't know, but there he was, just incredibly sweet and so humble. I was I was taken by him. That's my story.
Yes,
that's my story.
And that's it. And that's consistently.
Yeah,
okay. That was him all the time. But as bad as he and great as he was, he would lift you up and say, come on, no, mm-hmm. you can do it. And I'm like, right. mm-hmm. he said, no, come on. Push you, it gently. Mm-hmm. Never arrogant in the way of, oh, you know, if you can't do it, then, you know, go home and learn the part and then come back. No, mm-hmm. very, very gentle and inspirational. It's what a sweet soul.
Yes. Now, his relationship with the Beatles, he's the fifth Beatle.
Great guy.
So I know you met George and went through that whole world through him.
That's right.
Speak about that connection with you and how that yep. changed your life.
Well, being with Billy, mm-hmm. you would see Rod Stewart would come through
yes.
the ranch. A lot of people would come through, but here's George Harrison comes to visit at the ranch.
Yes.
And before that, we'd be at the Plaza Hotel in New York with Mick and Keith, you know, the Rolling Stones. You know, I've had long conversations with Mick Jagger, just talking about life and whatnot. We went to the record plant and jammed together, mm-hmm. you know, so mm-hmm. through Billy, meeting these top, the greatest of the greats. And then here comes George. It's cool, humble, quiet self, and met him at the ranch. And I had just left Chicago, Narada, doing some demos that Curtis gave me studio time to do these demos. So I had four songs I did, had my cassette always on me, and George was looking to sign X. Look at the sign X. That's I mean, once again, just in the right place at the right time. And he's like, do you have anything? I said, I just happen to have something right here. Boom. Yeah. He said, okay. I'd like to sign you. Billy pulled me over to the side. He said, Kenny, you know what you got to do, man? I said, what, Bill? You got to bring the brothers back. Because at that time, I was just playing bass. I'm on my own. I'm solo. So Billy said, man, you got to bring the brothers back. I said, Billy, I mean, Billy just trying to go now on my own. He said, come on, Kenny. I said, okay, that's how it happened.
I see, okay.
And then we came back and did this album for George called Second Resurrection.
Yeah, From Us to You, what is it called? From Us to You?
Yes.
Is the song?
Yes. Yes.
Right,
yes.
Okay.
Yes. Pasado, okay. You know, and so that's the story. That's the story. Wow. And then George and I had... A good relationship and friendship, and he would come out to my apartment.
Okay.
I was out in the valley, and wow. he would come by himself, no security, just him. And he's the one who hit me to where I was living, Narda. I didn't know LA at that time. Mm-hmm. So I'm out there in the valley in some apartments, and George came through. He said, Kenny, I see you're out here with the lowriders. And I'm like, the lowriders? The next month I moved.
Okay. Huh.
Because okay. I didn't know, you know, where I was, mm-hmm. you know? So that's George Harrison.
Wow, man.
You know, he yeah. could, he, you talk about like us.
Yeah.
George was that down to earth.
Mm-hmm.
That cool. Mm-hmm. You know, he was just, I mean, it's like, you're a Beatle. How are you yeah. out here by yourself? You're not that's supposed right. to be by yourself.
That's right.
But he moved through life easy.
Yes, he did. You know, who spoke teachers. About him as your
Those
friend.
Those were our teachers.
Yeah. I was on last week with a beautiful man who loved you, spoke to you about you and spoke about George, is Alvin Taylor, the drummer. He spoke about
oh,
you.
Oh, yeah. My brother.
Yeah, he sure
my
did.
My brother, Alvin.
He sure did. Yes, he did.
Alvin.
Mm-hmm.
And a beautiful soul and badass, you know. Let me tell you, when Billy introduced me to George, and then we brought the family back. My brothers came back and we did this album. We needed a drummer.
Okay.
And we were auditioning drummers. And Bob Margoloff, the great Bob Margoloff,
yes.
engineer, Malcolm right. Cecil, Bob Margoloff, right. Tonto,
yep.
Recommended Alvin.
Okay.
Recommended Alvin.
Mm-hmm.
So Alvin came out. And Clarence and I had a system the way we worked. He'd handle vocals, but I handled the musicians. I handled
right,
the track.
Right.
You know, I handled the tracks because the bass is driving it. So Alvin and I would lock in and I would say, no, Alvin, here, you know, follow me on this, mm-hmm. and the kick and the turnaround. So it was almost like the drums were orchestrated because he and I crafted it together. And this guy was like a, Alvin Taylor was like an octopus, man. The way he could play and shift around, and it's another sweetheart.
Yeah.
Another sweetheart. My good dear friend, Alvin. Yeah, and then of course meeting us, and then meeting George. That's how that happened.
Yeah,
got it. He met George from playing with us.
There you go.
You know, and then George, then Elton John. But he already had the pedigree because he was already playing with good pop rock acts. Mm-hmm. You know, Eric, what was his name? Eric something. I can't say the last name, but you know, popular pop and rock guy. So yeah, Alvin Taylor.
Yeah, man.
My brother, good guy. Love Alvin.
Wow, man. So then,
love him.
After you came to Los Angeles, you then settled back to then Atlanta. Am I correct?
Yes. Yes.
And why Atlanta?
I went back to Atlanta.
Mm-hmm.
Well, in the 60s,
yes.
When we would travel,
yes.
Curtis always praised Atlanta.
Okay.
Oh, it's a great town. It's up and coming. Your property. And Curtis had bought some property here. So when we would come to Atlanta, Auburn Avenue was like the strip then. This is back in the late 60s, mid-60s, early 70s. And then Atlanta blossomed in the early 70s and became this oasis where you could get affordable, beautiful apartments, beautiful homes. And it was all affordable. It was brand new. Mm-hmm. So nothing was run down. So everybody started coming here. So my family mostly moved here. My mom and my brothers.
Beautiful.
And I came back to Atlanta because I'm just really a family guy.
Got it.
You okay. know.
Beautiful.
So because my mom and my brothers and sister and dad right. were here. So yeah. So I, you know, I wanted to be, you know, after a while it gets lonely.
Yeah.
I you know, you grow up with a big family, man.
Mm-hmm.
You know. You know, you kind of have that need. So that's why I came back to Atlanta to be close with my family. Okay.
And like so much of the sound out of Atlanta has now changed the world with all the hip hop and the groove and the beat. And I love, for example, Hey Ya, my man, Andre 3000, all that work is coming out of there.
Yeah.
And then, okay, then your groove on Rise to the Top is just monstrous. The groove on Rise to the Top is monstrous.
Thank you.
You got to speak about how a person like you even finds that out of the universe. I mean, it's to its own. It is unto its own. That is you, that the good Lord says is a gift to you, Mr. Keni Burke.
That's it. Period, blank, dot. That's exactly how it happened.
Mm-hmm.
That's exactly how it happened. Mm-hmm. And guess what? The bass line is played on the keyboard.
God, I didn't know that either. I don't know what you're doing. I just know it's badass.
That's left hand.
I know it's badass. That
is, no. Listen, and I'm playing a Wurlitzer.
Okay.
I'm writing in Philadelphia on the Wurlitzer.
Okay.
But don't bang, bang, boom, I said, boom. But here it was. This is when I knew that the Almighty sent it straight to the shift and to the chorus. Back to it. And then putting a minor 9 chord in there. To the seven. So all of that was coming. You already know.
Yeah,
you
know,
right?
I love it. That's
where
so
it comes from.
Yeah.
You know where it comes from.
Yeah, that's beautiful.
Almighty God channeled that straight in. And when people ask me, how did you come up with it? It came to me. Mm-hmm. I didn't think it out. It came right to me. And how appropriate is it for you to receive something from Almighty God? Mm-hmm. And no one at that time picked up on it when it first was released. RCA. You know, it went top 40, but they didn't keep pushing and to make it go. But a DJ in New York, the great late Frankie Crocker.
Oh, yes. I love Frankie Crocker. God bless.
Playing that. Frankie, BLS, New York, right? Kept playing it. And then it just took on this slight kind of following with the young people, man, and block club parties, as they've told me how it would come up. So the LL Cool J's, the Puffies, the Mary J. Blige, all of these people, the Heavy D's, all were feeling the 50 Cents. The Fat Joes, they were feeling this. They were living this. And they all told me, Kenny, your song is the anthem. It's called the Queen's Anthem. Everybody in Queens, that was their song. And hard-hitting, you know, street dudes would come up to me and give me the sensei bow. And I said, you don't know what you did for us. Whenever we would get up and go out, we this was our song that would give us our inspiration. Give it all you got. Keep going. And I'm sitting back saying, all praise is due to Almighty God, because he gave me a gift and no man could take it away. If he says it's going to be something, it's going to be something. Yeah, and all of those young guys took it and sampled and made it known.
Yeah, man.
Not the label, those young guys, they made it known.
Yes,
and 50 Cent to this day became my good friend and brother.
Okay.
He put it on his third installment of his Power series called Raising Canaan. And he invited me to Madison Square Garden to perform with him in 2019, packed audience. And he was the first one to say, this is the guy who did that song. You don't know him. This is the guy. And he bought me out on that big world platform and then told me, I owe you for coming, Kenny. He said, I owe you for coming and doing this for me. I said, no, I owe you. I mean, no. He said, no, I owe you. He said, I'm going to think about something to do for you. Next thing you know, I get a call from his publisher. Your song is going to be the theme song for his new series.
Right. Beautiful.
Blessings again.
Mm-hmm.
A gift again.
Mm-hmm.
Gift.
Yes. Okay. Yes.
Fat Joe.
Ooh. Okay.
Fat Joe. I met him at a dear friend of ours. His name is Ted Smooth. Great DJ in New York from the Bronx, and our Puerto Rican brothers and Dominican brothers, right?
Right.
And I came to do Ted's. I came to do Ted's birthday party a couple years ago, and then Fat Joe slips in and, oh Kenny, man, I want to hear you do the song. I said, well, Joe, I already did it. He said, well, you got to do it again.
Yeah, that's like jam.
Let me run to the restroom. I'll be back. So I come back. He's gone. He thinks that I dumped him. As story tells, because he thought I left. I said, no, I went to the restroom and I didn't get back in time. So we exchanged numbers. We talked. He said, man, you got to come to my birthday party. I do these big gala bashes every year for my birthday in August. So he invited me last year. We had a great time. I met all my, all of the heroes of hip hop that have done my music.
Wow.
LL Cool J, Mary J. Blige, Swiss Beats. I met all of them. Busta Rhymes. And they were all so kind and gracious to me. And then he's inviting me back again this year.
Beautiful.
So, you know, we've been embraced. We've been embraced by not only we're talking about our roots from the 60s, the 70s. What a blessing. I have seven decades.
Yes, you do.
And still going. 60s, 70s, 80s, 90s, 2000, 2010, 2020.
That's it.
How does that happen? But only by the grace of Almighty God.
That's right, brother. And you look
and
great.
And you,
Kenny.
My friend.
And you look great.
Thank
Kenny.
You. I'm trying to keep up with you.
You look great.
No, listen, Narda, we got to slip it in now. What about this thing we're doing? Can we talk about this thing we're doing?
Sure. There's a magical piece of music you put together, Kenny, in honor of the great Little Anthony from the band with the Imperials. And he was always genius. Small man with this fantastic drama that you could not take your eyes off him and control of his voice on the pieces that I just knocked me flat of going out of my head in the early days and hurt so bad. with Teddy Randazzo's productions and all that. Phenomenal work.
Yes, yes.
Would knock anyone flat. From Burt Bacharach on down, we were all just knocked flat. So you got a hold of this little anthem. You put a piece of music together, Time on My Hands. And I'm so honored you asked me to play drums and work on it. And it's a killer. So bless you, Kenny. Speak on anything you want to say about Melanthony and your work on that. Go ahead.
Well, first of all, as everything you said is true, Little Anthony and the Imperials were one of the first shows our father took us to see in Regal, at the Regal Theater.
Okay.
So his hand movements, the way he could project himself when he would sing, right?
Yeah.
So we were always big Little Anthony fans. And I got to say this, over everyone else, even the Motown man.
Wow, I did not know that.
Little Anthony Imperials had something different.
Yes, they did.
Had something different.
Yes, they did.
Because of who? Because of Teddy Randazzo.
Oh, yes, sir.
Those string arrangements.
But say it again. People don't know this name.
Don Costa.
Okay. But people don't know these names. These are great
Teddy
names.
Teddy Randazzo.
Yes.
Tommy Bell.
Yes, of course.
Tom Bell. Gamble and Huff, Tom Bell, great arranger and writer. Bell and
La La means I love you, Delphonics.
The Stylistics, yes. all that. A Teddy Randazzo student.
Yes.
Burt Bacharach.
Yes.
Teddy Randazzo.
Yes.
They're in that same league. We got to give it up. What I hear David doing, David Foster.
Yes, of course.
With those hits and those kinds of movements, we're all Teddy Randazzo students, and nobody knows who Teddy Randazzo is.
Right.
Well, now they do. Mm-hmm. So we had the pleasure of meeting Teddy and visiting his home. He embraced us back in Nyack, New Jersey. So we met him, hung out with him. He showed us where he recorded those songs, in his living room.
What?
He recorded Hurt So Bad in his living room.
But the sound is so huge. Is this living room huge?
Yeah. The vocals. He did the vocals.
Oh, vocals.
Not the arrangements.
Okay.
The vocals.
Okay.
He's like, wait a minute. Yeah, living room.
Yeah. Must be a huge room, man.
What are we missing?
Okay.
But back to Anthony.
Yeah.
So it was always this reverence and high level of respect for him. Yeah. And never had met him. Knew Smokey, met the Temptations, Four Tops, all of them. But never met Little Anthony. So my cousin, Robert DeBlanc, is one of the Imperials. And when I was living in Vegas back in 2013, I came to their show and Robert introduced me to Little Anthony. First thing I did is hit a knee. I took a knee. And I said, listen, you don't know who you are and what you mean to me and everyone from your era. Everybody bows to you because you are the original. You there's no duplicate. There's only you. And he was so humble. And then I said to him, I want to record a track on you one day. I want to do something. And this song that we are doing now has been under progress for 6 years. Since I first started it. But you're the first one that I called during COVID. I took a chance. I said, no, this song needs real live musicians. So I said, let me call my brother, my friend, Narada, and we talked. And you very much quickly, like, Kenny, if it's you, whatever, I'm in. But you said, but by the way, who is it for? And I said, it's a Little Anthony. He said, okay, let's go. You know, let's go. And you came on board first, and I got to say this, that's not something you do often. I mean, you do play, but you're selective. So I took that as an honor for not just you doing it as a friend, but your level of professionalism cannot be compromised. So you had to trust me that if you were going to do that and leave it in my hands, that it was left in capable hands. And then, of course, then I made the rounds. So I called Michael Thompson, who is another sweetheart friend. I gave Michael what he says, because I just like kind of like shied away. He said, Kenny, you gave me my first opportunity. in the studio on a real session. So he said, I've always told your people, Keni Burke was the first guy that gave me a shot. And I said, you've done so many big records, Michael, that no, I was the one who saw your talent and was like, oh, I got to get this guy on this record. So it's that mutual exchange that we give back to one another. Right. And with then, of course, I had some props. I could run and say, well, Narda's on drums. Oh, Narda's on drums now. OK, Michael's on guitar. Clarence McDowell. OK, Najee. So we have this work called Time on My Hands. And it never was getting to where I knew it needed to sound. And I never wanted to come back to you. And I'm going to say this to the world and confess this to you. For all this time, I knew I wasn't getting it where I needed it to be, but I didn't want to double dip. You know, double dipping.
I got you, man.
He's already played drums on it.
Yeah, right.
Never to come and ask him if he'll help me, you know. But last week, I'm like, it's not there. And you said, okay, let's talk tomorrow. Yeah. And now here we are. You're there. You've already done the rhythm section and got your drums sounding like it sounds like you're playing them.
Thank you. Thank you.
And you bought all of the beauty out of it, and the sonics are there now. And then you bought your team on board as a gift. So no, thank you. Thank you. Thank you.
And we're bringing all that Jimmy Wright. So help me work it, who we love so much. And then we're
Jimmy Kill. Oh my yes. God.
And then yes. Dave Frazier comes on yes. Monday, who did the mixing on so many of our hits of License to Kill that you love from Gladys Knight and the Whitney Houston stuff, the Aretha stuff. So he'll be bringing his
the
master.
Top guy.
Yeah.
The top cats.
Yeah.
The
and then you have you and should listen, come and visit. Listen. Come visit our studio. Come visit our room, you know.
I would be honored. Would love to. I would love to. So now we have this great, and I spoke with Jim earlier because he was yes. setting things up.
That's right.
For this. Yeah. And he said, thank you so much that he loved the piece and how much it's a great, you know, to work on some real music, you know. Right. So I'm so honored, man, to be working with 5-time mm-hmm. Grammy Award winning producer.
Okay. Hey, so Michael, let me ask you this. I want to do more with you, Keni. I just want to say you're my guy, man. So whatever you want to do is open carte blanche. We love you, and all the new things for the future, just please keep us in your sphere. We want to be with you. So your dreams, if it's putting together a new 5 stair steps of young kids or whatever those things are,
yes.
That come across your heart,
yes.
We love your integrity, we love your spirit, and we love your musicality. So much of what you have in you is the richness we spoke about in the 60s that goes forward because you're a groove master. See, the funk never grows old. And because you put that funk on it, you can get away with them, that richness. See, if you didn't have that funk on you, no. But because you got that funk on you, you can do them. You can put those rich, beautiful things that we need still to go like, oh my God, for the future. That's you, Mr. Keni. So I want to just tell you
thank
that,
you.
Respect you, and need you for our future. So
thank you.
Come on, man. Come on.
Thank you, Narda.
Okay.
Thank you. Okay. Okay. Hey, this is great. And what you're doing with your podcast, I wish you well in everything you do. And you bring the spirit, and you bring your joy, and you bring your smile to all of us, Narda.
Thank you.
Thank you. Thank you so much.
Yeah.
And when you see that tent pitched out in the parking lot at the studio, you'll know who it is.
Okay,
it be me.
Okay. Well, everybody, I just want you to know, in wrapping up here, we've been talking to the great Keni Burke. Since my childhood, just rocked my world with his great singing and musicianship, songs with his family. The Clarence, who was the only person I know that could rival Curtis Mayfield vocally, and the way he just would deliver the songs. And you were just that our all any family. I come from the Walden family. Any family had to be like just like in awe of the Stairstep family, before the Jacksons, before anybody.
And the Jacksons were too.
That's right. We were all like, who are these people?
Yeah.
Even my dad would say, well, do you think you could put together, you know, the family to be like the Stairsteps? I said, no. No, those guys are incredible, man.
So, say it quick, Anthony. Yeah. Wow.
Yeah.
Anyway, here we love are, you. Still blessed yeah. to be here. Yeah.
That's right.
Love you too, Narada.
Yeah, man. God bless you,
all
Kenny.
Right. Okay. Thank you. Thank you for having me. Thank you. All right. Okay. Peace. Okay. Peace out. Love.
Thank you so much for listening to our All In podcast. If you enjoy the show, please follow, like, and subscribe on our socials, YouTube, Official Narada Instagram, Official Narada, one word, and All In with Narada Michael Walden on Apple Music, Spotify, and more. Thank you so very much.